Thank you very much. It's a great privilege and honor to be invited here to beautiful Stockholm. Thank you, Jussi, for the invitation. And as Jussi said, I'm going to talk about transcriptional enhancers. I love enhancers. I have never encountered an enhancer I didn't like, whether it's from worms, flies, or humans. I am into enhancers. These are, of course, short segments of DNA, typically a few hundred base pairs in length. They switch genes on and off in response to a variety of intrinsic and external signals. The very first transcriptional enhancer was discovered by Walter Schaffner in 1981 in his studies on the SV40 virus. And since that time, whole genome studies, actually from a number of labs here, including UC's, have identified as many as hundreds of thousands of enhancers in the human genome. And right now, it looks like a typical gene in our genomes is regulated by on the order of 10 to 20 different enhancers. So a whole lot of gene control. And also, as UC mentioned, there's emerging evidence that sequence polymorphisms are a major source of population variation and predilection to disease. And so what I'm going to do today is to discuss some of the basic properties of enhancer DNAs, drawing from our studies on two model organisms, the sea squirt Ciona and the fruit fly Drosophila. And I'm going to focus on three points regarding enhancer function. First, how do they integrate complex regulatory information to produce simple tissue-specific patterns of gene expression? Secondly, and this is what I'm going to dwell on most today, is how do enhancers control timing in gene expression? It's not enough just to switch a gene on in a particular tissue. You also have to turn it on at the right time, not just the right place, but the right time. And we don't know as much about the temporal control of gene expression as the spatial control of expression. And then I'm going to very briefly end with evidence for visualizing transvection, the ability of an enhancer on one homolog to activate the gene on another homolog. So I'm going to begin with a high-throughput analysis of a tissue-specific enhancer in the sea squirt Ciona, where this high-throughput methodology works pretty well. So let me just briefly say that's a sea squirt, not very impressive as an adult. These are simple marine creatures that live in shallow ocean waters, and they filter the seawater through these two siphons. Despite the primitive appearance of the adults, the embryos and larvae look like simplified vertebrate tadpoles with a head and a tail. The tail has a prominent notochord and dorsal hollow neural tube. There's no question that these are chordates, and in fact, molecular phylogenetic studies suggest that these tadpoles are among the closest living relatives of vertebrates. Now, a very nice property of this system is the ability to introduce transgenic DNA by simple electroporation methods. No need for microinjection and no need for germline transmission. We do transient electroporation introduction of transgenic DNAs. The adults are hermaphrodites, the white is sperm, the yellow are eggs. You cut these guys open, which I do without feeling any guilt. I mean, you know, these are simple. They don't bleed. They don't look back at you. They don't seem to suffer. I mean, in fact, they're like plants. This outer rubbery sheath is made out of cellulose. So without guilt, I cut these open, mix the gametes, and you get hundreds or even thousands of synchronously developing embryos. You mix a transgenic DNA of choice with those fertilized eggs, zap them by electroporation, and the transgenic DNA is efficiently incorporated and faithfully expressed. In this experiment, a CNS enhancer was attached to a LACZ reporter gene. In this experiment, a notochord-specific enhancer was attached to mCherry. And you can see a very nice tissue-specific expression of these reporter genes from electroporation. You electroporate at fertilization, wait 10 to 12 hours, you get your answer. So a postdoc in the lab, Emma Farley, decided to take advantage of this electroporation method to do a high-throughput analysis of an intronic enhancer from a homeobox gene called OTX, which is expressed throughout the neural plate of the developing tailbud and tadpole staged embryo. And the intronic enhancer, when attached to a GFP reporter gene, faithfully recapitulates the expression of the endogenous gene with strong expression up in the future brain regions and extending throughout the tail or neural tube regions. And here you see a group photo of many electroporated embryos. Now, previous studies done from Patrick Lemaire's lab show that this OTX enhancer is induced by FGF signaling in the neural plate. But FGF signaling is highly pleiotropic. It's involved in patterning a variety of different tissues in the developing embryo. And FGF signaling is not enough to trigger expression of this enhancer. There are these two ETS transcription factor binding sites, GGAA, which mediate FGF signaling, but they're not enough to turn the gene on. Activation depends on these two binding sites, these GATA transcription factor binding sites. At this stage in development, GATA specifically expressed in the neural plate. And so it's the combinatorial action of pleiotropic FGF signaling through these ETS binding sites and this tissue-specific determinant GATA, which gives you this localized expression in the developing neural plate. But Emma wanted to take our understanding of this enhancer deeper, and so she created 1 million variants of this simple 50-nucleotide enhancer sequence. She systematically mutagenized all the nucleotides between adjacent sites. She left the core ETS and GATA binding sites intact, and then systematically electroporated these 1 million variants into thousands of developing embryos, grew them up to the neurular stage, did deep sequencing of the RNA, and using a barcoding scheme, she was able to identify 20,000 what I call highly active enhancers. These are enhancers that are at least as active as the endogenous OTX enhancer, as the native enhancer, and they're mostly more active. So we can think of these as sort of up mutations. And this represents by far the largest collection of active enhancer variants identified in ovo in developing embryos. So then Emma asked, well, what do these enhancers share in common which permit their efficient expression in the early embryo? And she got a very clear-cut result, very simple result. The only sequences that are necessary and sufficient for enhancer function are these short dinucleotides consensus sequences flanking the core ETS and GATA binding sites. No other sequences were identified in this survey, including those that are highly conserved between the ETS and GATA binding sites in divergent Siona species. So conservation would not have helped us in this case. The key functional sequences are these short dinucleotides. And some evidence for that is shown here. In the top panel is one of the 900,000 enhancer variants, which is completely inactive when electroporated into the Siona embryo. And this enhancer, this particular one, basically lacks sequence similarity with the native OTX enhancer, although it contains the core ETS and GATA binding sites, but those are not enough to give any expression. In the middle panel, Emma created exactly the dinucleotide sequences present in the native OTX enhancer. She created those flanking each of the ETS and GATA binding sites in this inactive enhancer, and this was sufficient to restore activity to wild-type levels. Under these conditions of photography, that's the normal levels of expression. So that shows that these sequences are necessary and sufficient for OTX-mediated expression in the neural plate. Now, it turns out, and it took us a little while to appreciate this, that the dinucleotide sequences that were identified in this big survey, just asking what sequences mediate nice, strong expression upon electroporation in the Siona embryo, these dinucleotide sequences are poorly represented in the native OTX enhancer. The OTX enhancer actually has pretty poor matches to those sequences. And in fact, if you look at the extended ETS and GATA binding sites, these correspond to optimal recognition motifs identified in high-throughput DNA binding assays done by UC's lab and also by Martha Bullock's lab. And so the sad fact, at least for me, is that this native OTX enhancer has mediocre matches to these consensus. These are suboptimal ETS and GATA binding sites in the native enhancer. Because we're always looking for the best binding sites. You generate a recognition sequence motif, and when we survey our enhancers, we're looking for good matches to those motifs. This enhancer actually has pretty mediocre matches. In the bottom panel, Emma modified this dead enhancer to create precise matches to these dinucleotide consensus flanking each of the Etzengada binding sites. This gives stronger expression than the native enhancer, and you have maybe trouble seeing that here, but you'll see it in a moment. In addition to the stronger expression in the right tissue in the neural plate, there's a little bit of misexpression in the wrong tissue in the notochord, other sites of FGF signaling. All of a sudden, you start losing the combinatorial control of GATA and the ETS transcription factor, and pleiotropic FGF signaling becomes sufficient to turn on this enhancer when you get the optimized binding sites. So these experiments and others like it suggest that the native OTX enhancer intentionally uses mediocre recognition sequences to limit the sites of FGF signaling and give you specific expression in the neural plate. So Emma reasoned, well, if the native enhancer has mediocre recognition motifs, maybe it also contains suboptimal spacing between adjacent binding sites. And I'm not going to take you through all her experiments, but this summarizes some of them. In the middle panel, you see the native enhancer. The 5' pair of Etzengada binding sites are separated by 10 nucleotides. The 3' pair by 13 nucleotides. On top, she made a 10-10 configuration, so both spacings like the 5' pair, that enhancer is dead. But the reciprocal experiment shown down here, where both spacings are now 13 nucleotides, typical of the 3' pair of Etzengada binding sites, this gives a several-fold increase in the levels of expression. So these types of experiments suggest that the native OTX enhancer contains mediocre recognition sequences that are organized in a suboptimal fashion regarding spacing of adjacent sites, and that this suboptimization of this developmental enhancer is important for its chief mission, which is to give tissue-specific expression in response, in this case, to pleiotropic FGF signaling. And I would say the majority of developmental enhancers, if they're not responding to FGF, they're responding to some other pleiotropic signaling pathway, Wnt, Hedgehog, Notch, BMP. So we think this is a fairly general conclusion. The use of suboptimal sites. The idea of suboptimization is summarized here. So on the top panel, you see the native OTX enhancer, which directs weak but specific expression in the neural plate. In the bottom panel is the completely tricked out enhancer, where Emma created the optimal dinucleotide motifs adjacent to each Etzengada binding site, and also the optimal 13 nucleotide spacing at both positions between adjacent Etzengada sites. Now, this enhancer is going wild. You get very strong expression in the desired tissue in the neural plate, but there's also now substantial expression at all other sites of FGF signaling, the notochord, the anterior endoderm, and the hindbrain. And so these results suggest that it kind of breaks my heart, because as I told you, I love enhancers. And the truth is that developmental enhancers mediating tissue-specific expression, responding to pleiotropic signaling, cannot use the most elegant biochemical mechanisms to work, the optimal binding sites, the optimal spacing of binding sites to get cooperative interactions between the transcription factors, because as soon as you optimize the sites, you lose specificity. You get response, in this case, to FGF in the wrong tissues, such as the notochord. Now, it has been noted by many researchers that animal genomes, particularly vertebrate genomes, but also flies, have a lot of regulatory redundancy, multiple enhancers for more or less the same patterns of gene expression. Sometimes these multiple enhancers with overlapping regulatory activities are clustered together and called superenhancers. I'm going to show examples of pairs of enhancers in Drosophila where you have a primary enhancer and a secondary shadow enhancer. And it's possible that this regulatory redundancy deals with this problem of limits of gene expression, tissue-specific expression, and levels of expression. And I'll show you one example of what I mean here. So on the left, you see one of Emma's suboptimized OTX enhancers, weak but specific expression in the neural plate. On the right is the same enhancer, except that she made two tandem copies of the suboptimized enhancer attached to the GFP reporter gene. And this gives nice, robust expression throughout the neural plate in the future brain regions and in the future neural tube. So there's two ways to get strong expression in a tissue, in the neural plate tissue. One is by optimizing the enhancer, as I showed you. But the problem with that is you lose specificity. The other way is to have multiple copies of suboptimized enhancers, which work additively to give you strong expression without losing tissue specificity. So I think this is one of the main reasons why there's so much regulatory redundancy in animal genomes, so many extra enhancers. It's that trade-off between tissue specificity and the levels of gene expression. I should also note that this way of thinking about enhancers, developmental enhancers, as suboptimized raises the possibility that genetic disease could be caused by optimizing mutations, nucleotide substitutions, which actually improve binding affinity, which I think is just as likely to happen as a further loss in binding affinity, because these are already pretty mediocre sites. And that could give you dominant gain of function, misexpression of genes in inappropriate tissues. And there's some examples of that, such as mutations in the sonic hedgehog enhancer ZRS causing polydactyly. Looks like an optimizing mutation causing enhanced binding of a mediocre ETS transcription factor recognition sequence. Okay, so I've discussed a little bit about how enhancers produce tissue-specific patterns of gene expression, and now I want to turn to the question of timing. How do they control the temporal regulation of gene expression during the dynamic process of embryonic development? And for this purpose, I'm going to switch gears and move into the early Drosophila embryo. I'm going to focus on a one-hour interval between 2 and 3 hours after fertilization, because during this time, about 1,000 enhancers regulate the expression of a few hundred patterning genes to establish the fate map of the adult fly. So at hour 2, you have more or less like totipotent stem cells. And just 1 hour later, the cells are all irreversibly programmed to follow a specific pathway of development. By hour 3, a cell knows if it's going to be part of the antenna of the adult fly or part of the wing. So very rapid determination process. And an example of this process is shown here. UC mentioned this in his introduction. This shows the expression of a segmentation gene called Even Skipped. This is a side view, a 2.5 hour embryo, staying with an antibody against Eve. You can see it's expressed in a series of 7 stripes, which foreshadow the subdivision of the embryo into a repeating series of body segments. And as UC mentioned, these stripes are regulated by a series of separate enhancers located both upstream and downstream of the Eve transcription start site. And I'm just showing one of the enhancers. This is a 500 base pair enhancer located 1 kb upstream of the transcription start site, which controls the expression of stripe number 2. There's other enhancers up here which control stripe 3, other enhancers down there that control expression of stripe 1, and so forth. I just want to focus on stripe number 2. And over the years, we've learned a lot about how these individual activator and repressor binding sites lead to the spatial precision in the stripe 2 expression pattern. I'm just going to very briefly summarize that in this one slide. So here you see a high magnification view of a double stained embryo showing the first 4 stripes of Eve expression. And this was double stained to show one of the activators that switches on the stripe 2 expression pattern, Hunchback, which works combinatorially with the second activator, Bicoid. These are broadly distributed throughout the anterior half of the embryo. So in principle, the stripe 2 enhancer can be switched on in the entire anterior half of the embryo. Unlike the OTX enhancer, which I mentioned, which is solely regulated by activators, ETS and GATA, Eve Stripe 2 enhancer not only uses combinatorial activators, Bicoid and Hunchback, it also has binding sites for spatially localized repressors, and these are essential for restricting Stripe 2 expression within its proper limits. So here you see a double staining of the first 4 Eve stripes with a repressor called Giant in green. The Giant repressor pattern tightly straddles the anterior border of Eve stripe 2. Giant directly binds to the stripe 2 enhancer to shut it off and to form the anterior border of the stripe. And then another localized repressor, Krupel, is expressed in central regions of the embryo to form the posterior border. So the stripe 2 enhancer is integrating both positive and negative regulatory information to give you this precise stripe 2 pattern. And this is generally seen for a lot of the patterning that's occurring in the early fly embryo. Broadly distributed activators working together with spatially localized repressors to give precise patterns of expression. Okay, so now I want to discuss the temporal control of stripe 2 expression. Using these conventional methods of fixed tissues and antibody stainings, We've learned a lot about the spatial control of stripe to expression, but very little about the temporal dynamics. How is that stripe not just formed in space, but how is it controlled in time? How is it formed at exactly the right time, you know, roughly 40 minutes into nuclear cycle 14? And to address this question of temporal control, we collaborated with Thomas Greger at Princeton University to do live image analysis of the stripe 2 enhancers and other developmental enhancers active in the early embryo. And I should say, these live imaging methods were developed independently in Thomas's lab at Princeton and by Natalie Destotny at the Curie Institute in Paris. So I'm going to show you in the next slide, and I'm very proud to show this because I got to tell you guys, I am from Hollywood, California, and I am a total movie nut. I really am. And I even know the Ingmar Bergman movies, okay? I even know the kind of the gloomy Swedish movies. I know those movies and enjoyed them very much. Now, I'm going to show you in this movie the stripe 2 enhancer attached to a reporter gene, which contains a series of MS2 RNA stem loops, which bind with high affinity to a bacteriophage protein called MCP, fused to GFP. So you're going to see a living embryo expressing the stripe 2 reporter gene, and the nascent transcripts produced from the reporter are visualized with this MCP-GFP fusion protein. You're going to see green dots in the nuclei, and those correspond to the nascent transcripts. And the method's very sensitive, very dynamic. We can detect as few as 4 or 5 nascent RNAs at any given time. So without further ado, this is my godfather. I always wanted to be Martin Scorsese, a movie director. This is as close as I'm going to get. So initially, the stripe 2 reporter gene is very broadly transcribed through the embryo, silenced that mitosis, reactivated the next cell cycle, nice synchronous mitoses, silenced, and now reactivated. This is the 1 hour interval when the fate map of the adult fly is established. You can see the stripe 2 pattern take shape, but no sooner does it form than it disappears. A very dynamic and transient pattern of expression. Now, I've watched this movie about 23,000 times, so I'm going to burden you with one more viewing. So again, broadly transcribed early, silenced at mitosis, reactivated at the next cell cycle. Now we're going to enter nuclear cycle 14. That's that 1 hour interval when the fate map is established. The giant repressor binds to form the anterior border. The Krupa repressor binds to form the posterior border. And to our surprise, within 15 minutes after that mature stripe 2 pattern is formed, it disappears. Incredibly dynamic and transient pattern of expression. I've been looking at fixed preparations for 30 years, and I never imagined this degree of dynamics. I think, you know, the question of timing is sometimes hard to wrap your head around, and it really takes the live imaging to break it down. Now, it's possible that these extreme dynamics are fostered by a phenomenon called transcriptional bursting. And this is summarized on the next slide. So here's a snapshot of one of the stripe 2 movies taken right after the mature stripe 2 pattern is first formed. Nucleus 2 is located within the limits of the mature stripe. Nucleus 3 is located just behind the stripe. So I want to focus on these two nuclei, and on the right, you see the quantitative traces during nuclear cycle 14 from each of these nuclei. In the next 5 or 10 minutes, expression would be totally lost, and then gastrulation ensues. Okay. The x-axis is time in minutes. The y-axis is a fluorescence intensity, which scales with the number of nascent RNAs and the number of elongating RNA polymerases. And what you can see is that transcription is not uniform. It is episodic. It occurs in a series of bursts. Now, these bursts are variable, but on average, they run for 4 minutes and produce something like 20 mRNAs. So what we believe a burst is that a cluster of 20 polymerases are recruited to the Eve promoter. They are released one by one about every 10 seconds. So over a period of a few minutes, you now build up this train of elongating polymerases. They run along the reporter gene template. And as they start falling off, you recruit the next cluster of polymerases for the next burst. Now, transcriptional bursting has been identified in every system that's been looked at, from bacteria to human cultured cells. And it's possible that bursting renders gene expression more immediately responsive to dynamic on and off signals. And this idea that bursting fosters the regulation, the dynamic regulation of gene expression, is sort of seen here in this quantitative trace of nucleus 3, where you could see two cycles of bursting, and then the transcription is off. We know in this region of the embryo there is the localized Krupel repressor, which binds to the stripe 2 enhancer to form the posterior stripe border. We always find that the repression in these nuclei, in this region where Krupel is operating, that the repression occurs after a burst. It's as if Krupel has an easier time in shutting off gene expression by preventing the next burst, rather than having to switch off gene expression from some type of high, you know, Vmax level of expression. So the bursting, I think of it as a module of 4 minutes of regulation to provide very dynamic regulation. In the case of repression, it may be easier for the repressors to work at this refractory period between bursts and to prevent subsequent bursting. Now, to understand the relationship between enhancers and bursts, two postdocs in the lab, Takashi Fukaya and Bomi Lim, studied the regulation of a gene called SNAIL, which is shown here. Now, SNAIL is expressed in about 800 cells comprising the embryonic mesoderm. It encodes a zinc finger transcription factor, which coordinates the invagination of the mesoderm during gastrulation. And SNAIL is highly conserved in different animal systems, where it is used for a variety of epithelial mesenchyme transitions. And SNAIL has also been implicated in tumorigenesis. And in the fly embryo, it coordinates mesoderm invagination. Now, there's a very short lag between the onset of SNAIL transcription at 90 minutes following fertilization and this complex morphogenetic process at 3 hours after fertilization. The gene has 90 minutes to get properly expressed in these 800 cells, produce enough product to effect morphogenesis. And so SNAIL uses two tricks to ensure the reliability of expression in this critical 1.5 hour interval. First, it contains fully activated, paused RNA polymerase at the promoter prior to induction. And a former graduate student in the lab, Alistair Boddicker, showed that this pausing helps foster rapid and synchronous reactivation of transcription following mitotic silencing. A second trick SNAIL uses to ensure rapid and reliable expression is that it contains a shadow enhancer. It has two separate enhancers, which each activate expression in the mesoderm. And we find, by the way, that just about all the patterning genes active in the early embryo have shadow enhancers. And it deals with that question I raised earlier regarding the OTX enhancer in Sciona, the trade-off between the limits of expression and the levels of expression by having multiple copies of suboptimized enhancers. So there's even more marked regulatory redundancies in vertebrate genomes, but we already see some of that in Drosophila. And a former graduate student of the lab, Mike Perry, showed that the shadow enhancer is important for ensuring reliable activation of SNAIL transcription even under stressful conditions, such as increases in temperature. And if you remove the shadow enhancer, SNAIL first does come on in the mesoderm, but if you raise the temperature, it starts making mistakes and you get corresponding disruptions in gastrulation. Now, it turns out that the shadow enhancer is stronger than the proximal primary enhancer. And what I mean by that, it generates over the same period of time twice as many mRNAs as the primary enhancer. It also produces about twice as many transcriptional bursts as the weaker proximal enhancer. So here you see quantitative traces of individual nuclei of living transgenic embryos expressing MS2 reporter genes, where either the weaker proximal enhancer was placed in this downstream position, 8 kilobases from the transcription start site, and there are the MS2 stem loops used for detection of the nascent transcripts. And on the right is the same setup, except the stronger shadow enhancer was placed in this 3' position. And what we observe is that the shadow enhancer, the stronger enhancer in this 40 minutes of detection, produces about twice as many bursts as the weaker enhancer. The weaker enhancer, when it does generate bursts, those bursts are pretty comparable to the ones seen with the stronger shadow enhancer. It's about 4 minutes, it's about 20 mRNAs. So the bursting, the amplitude, the duration of the burst is not different when comparing strong and weak enhancers. What's different is that you make more bursts with the stronger enhancer than the weaker enhancer. So we believe in these experiments and others that the regulation of bursting frequency is a critical parameter of gene control and development. And some more evidence for that is shown here. In this experiment on the left, same thing as what I showed you before, a quantitative trace of a single nucleus from a living embryo expressing this MS2 reporter gene with the strong snail shadow enhancer in the 3' position. You get a bunch of bursts in this 40-minute period. On the right is the same reporter gene, except that Takashi inserted an insulator DNA between the distal enhancer and the target promoter. And we know that insulators interfere with the interactions of enhancers with promoters when positioned between the two. This insulator, it's a minimal insulator, causes about a 5-fold reduction in the amount of transcripts made from this reporter gene. It also leads to about a 5-fold reduction in the number of bursts. But when you get a burst, even with the insulator, that's a full-strength burst, 4 minutes, 20 RNAs, comparable to those seen with the unimpeded reporter gene. So altogether, these experiments suggest that a critical parameter in gene control is the frequency of bursting. Enhancers control bursting frequency. Strong enhancers produce more bursts than weak enhancers. So then Takashi went on to test a specific model that was near and dear to my heart. It's wrong, so I'm not going to dwell on it, about the basis for these bursts. And the model is very simple, that they arise from unstable enhancer-promoter interactions. So the idea is an enhancer loops to a promoter, dwells there for a couple of minutes, produces a burst, and then comes off. And then strong enhancers re-loop more rapidly than weak enhancers. This model seems to be wrong, and the next slide shows the experiment that Takashi did to test this idea. So he took different developmental enhancers, both weak and strong, and placed this downstream of the MS2 reporter gene, as I've described. He also placed it downstream from a second reporter gene containing PP7 RNA stem loops, a different bacteriophage system, which binds to the bacteriophage capsid protein PCP, this time fused to a tandem tomato. So the enhancer is equidistant between these two identical snail promoters, 8 kb downstream. We can detect the reporter gene on the left in green with the GFP fusion protein, the reporter gene on the right in red with the tandem tomato fusion protein. Now we expected, at least I expected, it's not a straw man, I really believe this is what we were going to see, that the enhanced, that we would get alternating red and green bursts. So according to the simplest models of looping, the enhancer would arbitrarily select one of the promoters, produce a burst, fall off, and then once again, jump ball, arbitrarily select one of the promoters. And the net effect over time would be to get alternating red and green bursts. But that's not what we observe. Instead, what Takashi and Bomi observed is coordinate bursting of the two reporter genes. So in this particular experiment, Takashi used a very weak enhancer in this position that just produces 3 bursts in this 30-minute period of analysis. And you can see pretty good coincidence of bursting of the two reporter genes, both the MS2 and the PP7 reporter genes. And this, I think, challenges classical models of enhancer-promoter looping interactions and also provides evidence that a single enhancer can simultaneously activate 2 different reporter genes, and we think actually 3 different reporter genes. But the main point I want to make here is that bursting is kind of a time module which permits rapid dynamic regulation, as I suggested to you in the case of Krupel forming the posterior border of EFSRIPE 2. Now, this two-color detection system that Takashi got working in the early fly embryo permitted a number of very straightforward experiments, including the question of what is the rate of Pol II elongation in the early Drosophila embryo. There's some controversy there. The estimates based on classical experiments, northern blot assays, nuclear run-on assays, is that Pol II in Drosophila runs along at a fairly glacial pace of 1.2 to 1.5 kb per minute. The problem with that is that we know there are large genes that are transcribed end-to-end during very short interphase cycles in the early cleavage-staged embryo, that with those rates of elongation, that's too slow for them to be expressed, and yet we know they're expressed. So Takashi re-examined this question by looking at the expression dynamics of a number of reporter genes containing MS2 stem loops at the 5' UTR and PP7 stem loops at the 3' UTR. And so now it's a question of, you look at the living embryo and you ask, what is the lag between the first appearance of green and the first appearance of red, the transcription of the MS2 stem loops, and then the transcription after a while, based on the length of the reporter gene, of the PP7 stem loops. Very straightforward experiment. This is an example of the studies. You'll see expression in the anterior regions of the embryo, and then after a delay, the red comes on as well. Okay, and it's that lag from onset of green to onset of red that gives us the elongation rates. And these are summarized in the next slide. Takashi, regardless of the promoter used, the enhancer, different reporter genes, consistently sees a rate that's twice as fast as previous estimates, 2.5 to 3 kb per minute, okay, with very little variation, just variation of 20 to 25% from gene to gene to gene. So we conclude a number of things from this. First of all, elongation is much faster than people thought. It finally explains why large genes can, in fact, be fully transcribed in the early embryo with very short interphase cycles. It suggests much more expression of zygotic transcription prior to the midblastula transition than earlier estimates. So it explains a lot of things. But the fact that the elongation rates are fairly constant also suggests that the regulation of Pol II elongation is not critical for developmental patterning. The main parameter of gene control is initiation and the frequency of transcriptional bursts. But these more rapid dynamics of transcription, 2.5 to 3 kb per minute, permits highly dynamic temporal patterns of gene expression and explains some of the things that we were very puzzled by when we first observed them using the live imaging. So in the next slide, I'm going to show you the expression of a gap gene called KNURPS in the abdominal regions of a developing embryo. The nascent transcripts, the nuclei are false colored just to show the sites of transcription of this reporter gene. And you're going to see, initially, the gene is transcribed in one pattern, but with time, it starts shifting into a new pattern. That'll be seen in the next slide. So here's KNURPS coming on. The first 10 minutes, you get a nice band of expression in the presumptive abdomen. And then after 10 minutes, Bomi Lim is simply changing the color to red to show the sites of newer transcription. And what you'll see is that there's this very subtle anterior shift in the de novo transcription pattern. I mean, there's no other way to see this except for with live imaging. So over the course of 20 minutes, the KNURPS pattern starts out in this yellow and green band, and then in 20 minutes, it shifts to the newer band consisting of the yellow and the red pattern. There's a shift of 4 nuclei in width as KNURPS is actively transcribed between minutes 10 and 30 in the early embryo. That may not seem like much, but that 4 nuclei width of transcription corresponds to an entire segment primordium. So this suggests some instability in the initial fate map of the fly, but more importantly, this is extreme dynamics. I mean, you're losing transcription here in just a couple of minutes, you're regaining it here in these new nuclei in a couple of minutes, and this could be best explained by those 4-minute module of transcriptional bursting regulation and the rapid dynamics, the rapid rates of Pol II elongation. And the last thing I want to say about this particular topic before I wrap up is that we have some preliminary evidence that these shifts in gene expression give you increased positional information in the early embryo. They may be important for segmentation. This is a very preliminary result. What you see on the left are the still shots from that movie, the initial Knirps expression pattern, and the final Knirps expression pattern in yellow and red, so you can very clearly see that anterior shift of four nuclei. This shift is mediated by this 5' enhancer. So this is an early intronic enhancer that gives you this initial band of expression, and then that gives way after 10 minutes or so in development to this 5' enhancer, which actually mediates the shift. So the intronic enhancer, I found this very interesting, the intronic enhancer is giving a static pattern of expression. But the 5' enhancer is literally mediating a dynamic shift in expression. And we find in the early fly embryo, some enhancers mediate movement, other enhancers mediate static patterns of expression. Eve stripe 2 is static. It refines, forms a stripe, and then disappears, but it doesn't shift after it's formed. But other segmentation stripes form and then actually undergo this type of shift. Now, what Will Rogers in the lab did was to use CRISPR-Cas9 to selectively delete this 5' enhancer, leaving the intronic enhancer intact, so you only get this early pattern. You don't get the shift in expression, and there's a loss of Eve stripe number 5, suggesting that the shift may be important in the patterning of the embryo. Okay, so now I just want to finish up. So I've emphasized the importance of transcriptional bursting and rapid rates of POL2 elongation and dynamic patterns of expression, such as these unexpected shifts in segmentation gene expression. And now I want to finish up by showing you evidence for transvection. Okay, and transvection was discovered by the great Ed Lewis in the 1950s, where he found complementation between two different mutations in the Hox gene UBX. And we now know that this complementation is best explained by regulatory sequences on one homologue, on one allele, activating the transcription of UBX on the other homologue, on the other allele. Okay, that's the interpretation of transvection. I want to show you some evidence for that. So this started with the use of the two-color detection system, PP7-MS2, to measure the levels of transcriptional output from each allele in a diploid locus. Okay. So what I'm going to show you here are some nuclei from a living embryo that's homozygous for a snail reporter gene. But Takashi and Bomi were able to paint these alleles two different colors using this MS2 and PP7 green-red system. On the left are homozygous embryos expressing both alleles, which we can now distinguish from one another. And on the right are heterozygotes, haploid embryos, in a sense, that only contain one copy of the reporter gene, the PP7 copy. And so I'll just run the movie. You'll see the two alleles come on here, red and green. But on the right, you just see the red allele. And what Bomi did was to measure the total transcriptional output from, in this experiment, the PP7 allele in the heterozygote, and that same PP7 allele at the same locus in the homozygote. And she finds that the allele produces higher levels of transcription when heterozygous versus homozygous. And it's very consistent, and it's a significant difference. You make 25% more transcripts when the PP7 allele is heterozygous than when it is paired with the second allele, the MS2 copy. So there's some kind of allele interference. Somehow, the two alleles are interfering with each other to give submaximal levels of expression. And the outcome of that is when you look at a heterozygote, you just delete a copy of the gene. You don't get half the amount of product, as you might imagine if the two alleles were working completely independently of each other, but you get two-thirds of the normal levels. Not a severe loss in the total output in the heterozygote, as you would expect if the alleles were acting independently. And I have to say, this kind of rings true. We just know anecdotally in the fly, a lot of heterozygotes make more than half the amount of product. Of course, it wasn't clear if that was transcriptional or post-transcriptional. At least in this case, it looks like it's de novo transcription. You take away one copy of the allele, the remaining copy spits out more bursts, more product. So now it's possible that this allelic interference, so when you have two alleles in the diploid, in homozygotes, somehow they're interfering with each other. And that interference may be due to transvection, okay, that Ed described for the UBX locus. And I'm just going to end by showing you evidence that we can, in fact, visualize this process of transvection. This gives me kind of goosebumps because Ed Lewis was one of my great heroes. And so what Takashi did in this experiment was very simple. He took different developmental enhancers and put them on one homolog without any reporter gene. And then on the other homolog, the other allele, is the reciprocal situation where you have the MS2 reporter gene driven, in this case, by the snail promoter. So in this experiment, it's a snail enhancer, but he sees this with different enhancers. Now, the only transcription you could get is due to the trans interaction of the snail enhancer on one homolog with the snail promoter on the other. And so I'm going to run the movie. It's not super efficient, but these dots show activation of the reporter gene in trans by the snail shadow enhancer. And so this does suggest that the two alleles are directly communicating, and that that communication could lead to this allelic interference that I mentioned, where you get lower levels of expression from each allele in a diploid than you would expect based on the amounts you get in a heterozygote. Okay, I want to end by thanking all the people who did the work I described. The first part on the suboptimization of the OTX enhancer was done by a postdoc in the lab, Emma Farley, who just recently started her own lab at UC San Diego, where she'll continue those studies. The evidence that enhancers control transcriptional bursting frequency and that a single enhancer can co-activate two different reporter genes simultaneously was done by two postdocs, Takashi Fukaya and Bomi Lim. And that's a team of an experimentalist and a computational biologist. The work on transcriptional dynamics, the shifts in Knirps gene expression, and the potential importance in the patterning of the embryo was done by a former postdoc, Izzat El-Sharif, and a current postdoc, Will Rogers. And then that last bit on allelic interference and the visualization of transvection, which I'm very excited about because now homologs are pretty clearly separated, we'll be able to look at the dynamics of enhancer-promoter interactions and correlate those with transcriptional readouts by using the transvection system that was once again done by Bomi Lim and Takashi Fukaya. And with that, I'll stop and thank you for your attention and take any questions.